This video deals with various aspects of arithmetic support in MIPS. First, let us recall the representation of integers in computers. We use binary or bits to represent integers. There are three main possibilities here: sign magnitude representation, one's complement representation, and two's complement representation. To help you recall these representations, here are a few questions. How would you negate a number in sign magnitude representation? Next, how will you negate a number if it is represented in one's complement representation? And finally, how will you negate a number if it is represented in two's complement representation? What are the advantages you can think of for the two's complement representation over the other two? Which representation do you think MIPS uses and why? MIPS uses the 2's complement representation for integers due to its various advantages, such as a single representation for 0 and uniform arithmetic for addition of signed as well as unsigned numbers. MIPS supports both signed as well as unsigned representations for integers, and this has implications for the instruction set architecture. For example, the instructions load byte and load half word have unsigned versions corresponding to them, load byte unsigned and load half word unsigned. So what is the difference between load byte and load byte unsigned? Do we need a separate instructions for load word unsigned? Do you think there is such an instruction? The arithmetic instructions we have encountered, namely add, add I and sub, all three have an unsigned version corresponding to them. What other instructions among those we have seen so far do you think has an unsigned version? The set less than and set less than immediate instructions have corresponding unsigned versions as well. Now here are a few questions in this context. Is the result of add and add u the same always? Given that they are the same, why do we have a separate addU instruction? It turns out that you can use a single SLTU or SLTIU instruction to check whether a given array index is within the bounds of the array. Think of how this can be done. Of course, there is more to integer arithmetic than just addition and subtraction, which is what we have seen so far. We also need to support multiplication and division. For multiplication, we have these two instructions mult and multu, which deal with signed and unsigned integers respectively. Of course, when you multiply two 32-bit integers, you can have the result which is larger than 32 bits. So we potentially need to store the result of the multiplication in a 64-bit storage location. MIPS has two special registers called high and low, and the result of multiplication gets stored in these two registers. The higher order 32 bits in the 32-bit register high and the lower order 32 bits in the 32-bit register low. Note that these two registers high and low are not part of the set of 32 registers which are visible in the MIPS instruction set. Just like multiplication needs to use 64-bit result, the operation of integer division also has a different need for using 64 bits. In division, we have quotient and remainder in integer division. So the div and divu instructions store the quotient in low and the remainder in the high register. Given that these two registers high and low are not part of the set of 32 registers in the usual MIPS instruction set, the question is, how do we get the result of multiplication or division from these two registers high and low? So MIPS has special instructions MFHI, which stands for move from high. Similarly, MFLO, move from low, with a single register argument each for moving the value from high or low to the given register. Now there is a large set of higher level language programs which use floating point. Hence the MIPS instruction set needs to support floating point instructions as well. Before we look at these, recall the normalized scientific notation for floating points. So in this notation, we have a sign bit, a significand in the normalized scientific form, and an exponent, which is actually biased 2's complement representation. There is an IEEE standard by the number IEEE 754, which supports single precision as well as double precision. Single precision uses 32 bits, of which 1 bit is the sign, 8 bits for the exponent, and the significand uses 23 bits. And in double precision, we have 64 bits total, which is made up of 1 sign bit, 11 exponent bits, and 52 bits for the significand. Recall that this representation also supports what are known as subnormal numbers, that is numbers between 0 and the smallest number possible with the smallest exponent. The representation also supports special bit patterns for NaN or not a number. So floating point numbers in MIPS use this standard, and the same standard is used in programming languages such as C as well. Float in C is the single precision version, and the double data type is the double precision version of floating point. Both of these are supported in MIPS as well. MIPS has a specific set of instructions for floating point arithmetic. For addition, we have add.s, which is floating point single precision addition, and we have add.d, which is the double precision version of floating point addition. Similarly, we have subtract, sub.s as well as sub.d, and likewise multiplication and division in single precision and double precision as well. Next, we also have comparison operations for comparing floating point values. We can compare for equality, not equal, less than equal, greater than, and greater than equal. And each of these comparisons also support single precision as well as double precision. So a typical comparison instruction will look like this. For example, we have c.eq.s for single precision equality comparison. Similarly, we can have c.le.d for double precision less than or equal comparison. So MIPS supports all 12 possible combinations here, 6 possibilities for the type of comparison and 2 different kinds of precision. The result of each of these comparison instructions is to set a special bit. This special bit is not part of any register, but it can be used directly in the next instruction through either BC1T or BC1F. BC1T compares the value of the bit with 1, and if the bit is set, it takes the branch, and BC1F does the opposite. If the bit is not set, it takes the branch. So this is how you can implement branching based on comparison of floating point values. Now in this instruction, B here stands for branch, T stands for true, and in this F stands for false. You may be wondering, what is this C1 doing here? This terminology comes from early implementations of MIPS, where the floating point arithmetic was so complicated that there was a separate processor called the coprocessor, which was responsible for doing all floating point arithmetic, and hence this goes by the name of C1. So this compares the bit in coprocessor number 1 and takes the branch if that particular bit is set. Now you may be wondering, well, these are the floating point instructions, what registers do they use? It turns out they do not quite use the same set of registers as the registers for the regular MIPS instructions. MIPS has a separate set of 32-bit floating point registers, which are used for floating point instructions. Here is a question for you. So we have 32 registers, 32 integer registers, and separate 32 floating point registers. That makes a total of 64. However, in our instruction encoding, we saw that we had only 5 bits for specifying the register number. Why do you think we don't need 6 bits? Well, the answer lies in the fact that the floating point registers are applicable only for the specific floating point instructions. So the instruction type itself determines whether we use the floating point 32-bit register set or the other regular 32-bit register set. Now these 32-bit floating point registers, the same set of registers can also be considered as 16-64-bit floating point registers for double operations. So MIPS also supports transferring of data from and to memory between these registers. So load word C1, load double C1, store word C1 and store double C1 are the instructions for moving back and forth between these registers and memory. So note that these instructions LDC1 will actually involve a 64-bit transfer from memory, and SDC1 will involve a 64-bit transfer to memory. It is useful to recall in this context common programming bugs related to representation of numbers within computers. These bugs are common to both higher level language and assembly language. One common bug is to use a signed number where you intended to use an unsigned number, or vice versa. Another is not handling overflow. Specifically related to floating point operations, it is not safe to assume in your code that floating point operations are associative. In mathematical terms, floating point multiplication, for example, is associative, and so is addition. However, in computer arithmetic, it is not necessary that A times B times C computed in these two different ways will necessarily produce the same result. A related aspect is that of floating point precision. For example, it is never safe to do a comparison such as x equal equal y, comparison of equality, in your code when at least one of them is a result of a floating point operation. So let us end this video with this question. So in floating point arithmetic, if you wanted to compare equality, what is a safe way of doing it?